Hi everyone, Eric here. In this video, we're going to build a private equity style discounted cash flow model to value a company with a bonus sensitivity analysis at the end. Okay, let's get started. So the point of this model is we need to figure out what do we think the future cash flow of this business is, and what do we think those future cash flows are worth today? And for the purpose of this analysis, the best cash flow metric we can use is unlevered free cash flow. And this is basically the cash flow that we will have available to us as owners if we want to pay down debt or pay ourselves a dividend, but after we've paid for all of the expenses of the company. So really what cash is available to us. So in order to calculate this, you need a couple metrics that you can see here. All of these metrics you could easily pull out of a three-statement financial model. That's the income statement, balance sheet, cash flow statement. If you don't know how to build one of those, I'll include a link in the description below. I uploaded a video on how to build from scratch an entire three-statement financial model. It's on my channel. Anyway, so if you had one of those models, you could pull these metrics out. You would have EBITDA, which we'll use for the terminal value. You have EBIT, which is your operating profit. And so to get from EBIT to unlevered free cash flow, you start with your operating profit on the income statement. Then you need to subtract taxes. We know we're gonna have to pay taxes. That's gonna come out of our cash flow, absolutely. Then we actually add back depreciation and amortization. Why? Because this is a non-cash expense. We put it on the income statement as part of the accounting matching principles, but it's not cash out the door. It's just something that we do because of accounting rules. So this cash is actually something we need to add back because we still have the cash. Then we need to adjust for changes in net working capital, which is current assets minus current liabilities. So these are cash changes in the short-term assets and liabilities on our balance sheet. And finally, we need to subtract capital expenditures, CAPEX. So this is any assets we bought, because if we buy an asset, that cash is gone. So after we've done all that, we have $334,000. And let's say this is year one. This is actual financials, and then everything from 2024 forward are projections. And so we can just, you know, apply a little color to that just to make sure that we don't forget. And so we're trying to estimate the value of these cash flows. But there's one more thing we need to do. At 2028, we're going to assume that we are going to sell the company. So what do we think the company is worth in that year? Well, there's two ways to calculate this number. And this number is basically called the terminal value. It's the future value of the company at a future date. So the first method is the EBITDA multiple method. So for typical private equity backed companies that generate significant EBITDA, maybe grow 10, 20, 30% a year, this is gonna work. And so let's say companies like this one are selling out in the market for 10 times EBITDA. So we're gonna put in basically a market multiple, because we're saying, okay, in 2028, we think this company will be worth 10 times its own EBITDA. So we take the EBITDA of the company here, and we multiply it by 10. So that gives us $14.9 million. So that's one way. The second way is this something called the perpetual growth method. It's worth taking a look at, but probably less accurate and definitely less used in the real world. And for this method, we're gonna need basically two metrics. One is a metric called the terminal growth rate. And so the terminal growth rate is what we think the company is gonna grow at in the future forever, in perpetuity. That's why they call it perpetual growth. And so if the economy is growing 3% in the country that you're doing this deal in, we're always gonna assume that the terminal growth rate is less than the economic growth rate. So if it's in the US or Europe or something, it's gonna be like 2%. And it could be less or it could be more. And that's one of the reasons, if you change this number just a little bit, the valuation gets thrown way, way off. And that's one of the reasons why the perpetual growth method is a little bit wacky. It doesn't, you know, people don't have that much faith in it. The other thing we need is a discount rate, which is the WACC. And you could release, you know, you could do an entire semester on exactly how to calculate this. 10% is probably a reasonable number, but it depends on how much debt in the equity the company has, what are your inflation expectations, how risky the whole thing is, you know, what's the opportunity cost of the money you're putting into it. And so there's a bunch of things, but 10% should give us a reasonable number here. So the formula is you take your unlevered free cash flow and you divide it by your discount rate minus your terminal growth rate. That's the formula. And you'll see that this gives us a value, terminal value of 13.166 million, a little under your EBITDA multiple. In this case, they're pretty close together, but if the EBITDA multiple is like really, really high, if it was like 20 times or 50 times EBITDA, which that's the kind of valuation you could see with a super, super high growth tech company, then you start to see that this perpetual growth method, it's not super informative. And so you're gonna have to use something that you see out in the market actually to value the company. So, and this is the cash and the debt that the company has. So for now, let's figure out how to value the company based on the net present value of its future cash flows. So we have our unlevered free cash flow. And I'm just creating a second line here because we need to add our terminal value to year five. Year five. We need to put them in the same year. And now we will have the net present value of your cash flows. So here you go. Here's the formula. You take your cash flow, so we're 1 year in the future, and you divide it by one plus the discount rate. Let's lock the discount rate. I hit F4 to do it. Raised to the power of, in this case, one, because you're only 1 year in the future. And to do this automatically, I'm going to take 2024, and I'm going to subtract 2023 and lock 2023. So what does this give us? 1 divided by 110% to the power of 1. So you can see this gives us a net present value of $400,909 for this cash flow in the future. So what about year 2? In this year, you see that we're raising the denominator to the power of 2, 2025 minus 2023. So in this row, we can calculate the net present value of all these cash flows. Now, the only thing we need to do is add up all of these different cash flows. And so the sum of all of these is actually called the enterprise value, you know, the net present value, the whole thing, but it's called the enterprise value. And we're going to talk just in one moment here about whether that's the number that we want. So the enterprise value, if we just add up these cash flows, is going to be $11.8 million. There is also a formula to do this, so you could skip a step just for your information. And in this case, it's called the NPV formula, not surprisingly. So you open the parentheses, you link in the discount rate, it tells you right here, rate, then comma, and then you grab the unlevered free cash flow. So it's going to discount all these free cash flows for us. So if we close the parentheses, you'll see we get the exact same number because they do the exact same thing mathematically. So that's just for your information. Do it however you want. And the thing that we're really after here, we have the enterprise value, but enterprise value doesn't take into account what's on the balance sheet. And so we need to make some adjustments based on what the company owns and what the company owes, because we're trying to get an equity value, because we're trying to buy the equity of the company or figure out, you know, what is the equity value of the company. So the basic formula is you take your enterprise value, the value of its cash flows, and you add any cash the company has to it, and you subtract any debt the company has. So in this case, the equity value is higher than the enterprise value. Why? Well, when you buy a company, if it has the cash on the balance sheet, you're going to get that cash too. So you should increase the price by that cash because you're just going to get the cash right back. But you also assume any debts that the company has. So you should be decreasing the value of the company by what the company actually owes, because now you're going to owe that as the owner. So this gets us the equity value. This is the discounted cash flow valuation of the company. $12.3 million. So now we want to look at one other thing. we're going to run a sensitivity analysis data table to see how the discounted cash flow valuation changes when we change some of the assumptions of our model. Right now, you'll see what we're going to do. So, on this side, let's look at the discount rate. And so we used a discount rate of 10%, right? Well, what if we used slightly higher and lower discount rates? So let's say we had 8%, 9%, 10%, 11%, 12%. Maybe we calculated it incorrectly. And with these models, it's not a science. It's you need to be aware of the market. You need to look at a range of assumptions to make sure that you're, you know, giving a valuation that actually makes sense. And let's say on the other side, let's actually move this over one cell. Let's say on the other side, you want to look at different exit multiples. Because let's say today, this kind of company that we're looking at trades at, you know, 10 times EBITDA. But in the past, in this sector, companies have sold at 7 times. And they've sold at, you know, all kinds of different EBITDAs. So let's say we want to look at 8 times EBITDA, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Okay, so here's how you set this up. First, let's just put a little border on the table. So I'll just put some little borders so you can see what is going on. I'm going to link in the equity value. So with these tables, you need to basically put hard-coded assumptions along the top and left. And then you need to link in with a formula equals, and you need to link the metric from your model. Now, you need to highlight this whole section with the assumptions and with the formula, go to the data tab. Now, what if analysis and data table? So the row inputs, what inputs are in this row? Discount rate. So we need to click discount rate. Now, column inputs. What inputs are in the column? That is the EBITDA exit multiple. Now click OK. So what you'll see here in the center of the table, if I just format it a little more nicely, are different equity values at these combinations of assumptions. So let's say the discount rate is 11% and the exit multiple is 8 times EBITDA. Well, in that case, your equity value is only about 10 million. And just so you can see, if we change this to 11, this is 10.0 million. If we change this to 11% and we change the EBITDA multiple to 8, you'll see that this is the same number, 10 million. So this allows us to look at all of these combinations of assumptions in this table. Oh, what if the discount rate's 12% but the X multiple is even higher? And so then you get sort of a sense of what is possible with this company. You know, within these variations, what is a reasonable price? What is a reasonable valuation? So that's all for this video. I hope you're feeling really confident now about basically creating a discounted cash flow model. If you like this video and want more, hit the like button right now. Let me know in the comments. Subscribe to my channel. I'll be releasing more videos like this. And if you want to improve your Excel skills, check out some of my Microsoft Excel training courses below in the description. Thank you for your time, and I'll see you in the next video.